create cool and inspiring events at Ad America? Easy. You can go to our website at www.adamerica.or.id. If you have kit, then choose create an event, then click collaborate with us, fill the form, upload your documents if needed, then click submit. Still confused? Then you can download a proposal example as your guide. After you have submitted your proposal will be going through a review process by our team. And why are you still here? Go to our page now and send your creative ideas to us. We'll be waiting for you.
Hi everyone, I'm Fina, one of the advisors for Education USA here in Ad America, who is ready to help you with your study plan in the United States. We can help you with many things, and here are some of the services that we provide for you guys. And how can you get access to any of this?
Pada Ramadan tahun ini, masyarakat di seluruh dunia, termasuk warga Amerika dan Indonesia, sedang bekerja, belajar, dan beribadah dari rumah. Meskipun kita berjauhan secara fizik, semangat kita tetap bersama dalam menjadikan bulan suci Ramadan sebagai momen untuk refleksi diri dan peduli dengan sesama. Saya Heather Variava, Kuasa Usaha Ad Interim Kedubes AS, mengucapkan selamat menunaikan ibadah puasa.
Hello everyone. Welcome to Ad America TV. My name is James, one of the e-guides here at Ad America, and we welcome our audience members joining us online. We hope that you are doing well and staying safe. Ad America is the U.S. Embassy's American Center, and our mission is to provide a safe space for young Indonesians to learn more about the United States. We have temporarily moved to a solely digital platform so that you can enjoy us from the comforts of your own home. Don't forget to leave your questions in the comments box section, and our panelists will answer them in this seminar. For those of you joining us through Zoom, welcome. There are a couple of features that you can use to actively participate with us. You can leave your questions in the Q&A box section. And if you want, you can also use our chat box section to say hi to the other participants and our panelists. In this episode, we'll be having Indonesian student success stories. But before we begin, I have a little icebreaker game. True or false? Harvard is currently offering free online courses. Stay tuned until the end of this program because we'll be giving live shoutouts to whoever answered them correctly at the end of the event on our Facebook Live comment. Don't forget to take a selfie and tag at America's Instagram account. Without further ado, let me introduce you to today's facilitator, Kak Santika. Santika, how's it doing?
Hi, James. Thank you. I'm doing great. How are you doing?
That's good. I'm doing great, too. Are you ready to start the event?
Yes.
All righty. Take it away.
All right. Thank you, James. Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming and joining us today in another Education USA events this week. This is the first Indonesian Success Stories event we hold this year. We usually have several of these events in a year, and this one is the first of 2020. For those of you who, you know, just came in to find out what is Education USA and everything, and this is your first time, welcome. And for those of you who repeatedly come to our event, thank you for always attending. And I want to let you know, please find the chat box in Zoom, or you can comment in any platform that we are live streaming if you have any questions later on. So today's event is basically about finding out what works for one of the students who applied to United States University and a scholarship, and he got the both of the scholarship and the letter of acceptance from the university. So I'm going to interview the student and you know, what kind of tips and what kind of journey he have. And I'm hoping that all of you can learn a lot from his experience and apply it in your daily life so that you can also follow the successful footstep of him. And it will be in Bahasa Indonesia, which I find is more comfortable for sharing. And since we are in Indonesia, and for those of you who are staying home, I hope you are staying safe and healthy. For those of you who are fasting, selamat berbuka puasa, and I hope you will enjoy this. Fina and I are going online, as mentioned by James and the video before you watch before we start talking. We are going online. That means any advising session that is usually held in at America Education USA at America is going online via Zoom meeting. So if you're interested, you can just join us to Zoom meeting. Our meeting ID is 276-124-396. We are available every day from 1 until 9. We are never closed. It's the same as the at America. The only difference is we are online and doing it digitally. And if you're too shy to, you know, jump into the Zoom, you want to start with email, that's fine. You can email us at jakarta.atamerica@educationusa.org. And I encourage all of you to turn on your video and use the chat box appropriately so that you can, you know, have fun and look at other people and other participants today. And I will introduce you to Fina so that she can tell you what is Education USA is about. Hi, Fina.
Hey, Santika, how are you?
Good, looking great.
Thanks.
Okay, take it away.
All right. Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining in. My name is Fina. I'm one of the advisors from Education USA in Adam America, in Pacific Place. But then, of course, like what probably all of you guys already know by now, that we are currently going virtual. And exactly what Santika said, we are going virtual, meaning that not only we are keep you updated with a lot of information about studying in the US, but we can also do definitely a one-on-one advising session. And so if this is your first time, welcome to Ed America TV. If this is your second, third, fourth, fifth time attending our events, welcome back and thanks so much for joining in. And if you know, like if you've been here before, usually I would be the one who lead the discussion, but then now I would like to let my colleague Santika to do that part. And so I'm going to pretty much kind of like behind the scene tonight, I'm gonna interact with you guys in the chat box. So if you guys here in Zoom, thanks so much for joining in. But if you guys are also watching us from other social media platform, we are on Instagram Live now. We are also on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. So we are pretty much like everywhere. Stay there if you want, and if you have any question, leave it in the comment section. And then our team, we already have like our team who will collect the questions, and Santika and I will, you know, try our best to answer each and any question of, that you guys have. So I'm going to just give a little bit of information if this is your first time and you're wondering who we are. So Education USA, we are part of the State of Department Network in the United States. We have over 400 international student advising centers in more than 170 countries all over the world. So we are practically everywhere. And in Indonesia, of course, not only in Ed America, but we actually have 8 centers total with 10 advisors. So we have 2 in Jakarta. We have also 2 in Surabaya. We have 1 in Medan. We also have 1 in Malang, Makassar, and Banda Aceh. So I'm going to shout out the advisor's name. So in Jakarta, we have 1 at the U.S. Embassy with David and Iqbal. And then, of course, the other center is in Ed America, although we are currently going virtual, but there are Santika and myself. And then we also have one in Surabaya at the U.S. Consulate General with Husky. And the other one is at the UNAIR, Universitas Erlangga, with Ambar there. And then we have one in Medan, also similar like in Surabaya. There's one at the U.S. Consulate Medan with Jeffrey. And then we have one in Malang at Universitas Muhammadiyah with Zaki. One in Makassar at Universitas Fajar dengan Cendani, and then last but not least we have in Banda Aceh at Universitas Islam Negeri Araniri with Lilis. And I know some of you guys probably are not in one of this, you know, not living in one of this cities, the one that have education wise centers, but don't worry. Basically, you can reach out to us or maybe the nearest education wise center, because all of our advisors, we are practically doing the same thing. We are here to assist you guys who wants to study in the US for higher education. So higher education means bachelor's degree, master's degree, or PhD, S1, S2, and S3. All right. And there are 5 steps to U.S. study, the ones that we provide to you guys. So we start with step 1. So if you were here yesterday or on our previous events, there was one where we are practically covering all steps. But step 1 is research your options. So if you're still in the very early stage in the application process, or maybe you're not in the application process yet, you're still trying to decide whether or not you need to study in the US, or maybe you need someone to convince you why should you study in the US, we are going to do it. We're going to help you on that. So any questions that you have about studying in the US, please let us know. So that's what researcher option means. And then of course there are, you know, like a number of, well, there are actually a lot of options for you to choose to study in the US. And then once we confirm that, like, you know that you're going to study in the US and you're ready to move on to the next steps, you know what university that you're going to apply, you know for certain the major that you're going to take, we can move on to step 2, which is finance your studies, because that's equally important. There are a number of funding options available out there, especially if you are planning to study for master's or PhD. We got Fulbright scholarship from both the US and Indonesia. There's also one provided by the university. So we're talking about that a lot on step 2. And then once we figure out on how you guys are planning to fund your study, we can move on to the real deal, which is step 3, completing your application. That's when things get more technical, because we're talking about transcripts, we're talking about building your resume or CV, finding the right recommenders to write the letters of recommendation, and the standardized tests. If you are still in high school, you may need to take the standardized test called SAT or ACT. Maybe you're, like confused between the two and which one should you take. Or maybe if you are, want to study for master's or PhD, the universities might ask you to take GRE or GMAT. And then, of course, we also have the English standardized test, which is either TOEFL or IELTS. And then, of course, last but not least, the one that is very, very important is the U.S. admission essay. And the good news is that's one of the services that Santika and I can help you with. And I would say that particular session, which is the essay review, is the most popular one that people would come to Education USA America for that, and we are always happy to help you guys with that part. And then once we are done with step 3, you're going to submit everything, and then you're going to wait for a couple of weeks or a couple of months until you heard back from the university, And once you get accepted, we can move on to the next step, which is step four, that is apply for your student visa. We are currently have about 54 people already got accepted for fall 2020. And congratulations for those of you, probably some of you are currently watching this session. And of course, shout out to an incoming student that we're going to have tonight. He's one of them, right? And so I know, and also I know that the current situation is, you know, we can fairly say that it's impossible for you right now to apply for your student visa because currently the visa office here at the U.S. Embassy Jakarta is currently not available. But we have been receiving questions from people just wondering, you know, let's say the visa office, you know, will be opened soon. We get a lot of questions wanting to know how long would the whole visa process will take. And then that's something that we can also help you with, telling you guys the step-by-steps in terms of applying for the student visa. And then of course, step five is my favorite time of the year. Although most likely we're not going to have it this year, but hopefully we are going to. That is the prepare for your departure. That is part of our annual event where in Ed-America, we have this every year. We invite all the incoming students to Ed-America, and then every accepted students will receive a name tag. So it's a really good way for you to mingle and, you know, basically networking with the other incoming students. But then of course, because all of our events is always open for public, so even though you are not leaving yet to the US, you are also more than welcome to join. Stay tuned on that. Again, we can't promise you that we're going to have it this year because we see more and more students prefer to defer their study from fall 2020 to fall 2021. And that's something that we're also going to cover with our guest tonight. All right. And so without further ado, I would like to give you back to Santika. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Fina, for the, you know, extensive introduction and the step-by-step on how to, you know, seek guidance from us and study in the U.S. So I want to let you know that usually in America, each of our event will cover our next upcoming events. I know that you just came in here for the, you know, Indonesian student success stories, but I want to let you know, next week we are going to have everything you need to know about master's degree or PhD programs in the United States. That's on Wednesday, and on Friday, we are going to have Saturday, we are going to have scholarship opportunities to study in the United States. You can find the details, of course, in our website, www.atamerica.or.id, or you can just go directly to the Education USA tab on that website, and you can find the events on the bottom. You can register just like what you did. And hopefully it will be also very useful for you. And next, I want to tell you, of course, don't be shy. Today we will have a good discussion. So I will play a recording later, but we will have a, you know, short polling to break the ice. By now, I think Fina, you know, is very excited to talk about the pre-departure orientation, and you're wondering like, why is this, you know, this event only have one student or one guest to talk about the success stories? In reality, we have at least 50 students accepted by now in our database. But of course, we cannot make one with all of the students here, and that's meant for PDO. So I want to let you know that your chance is, you know, not, you know, like, nothing to go to US to study. And I will start the polling in just a minute when Fina is ready with the polling. Okay, so let's launch the polling, Fina.
Alrighty.
Okay, so yeah, I'll give you a minute, but I will still try to distract you. because that's what I should be doing here, right? So the first question is, what level of degree do you want to study in the United States? We have bachelor, master, and PhD, and the last option is not planning to study in the United States. And the second question is, what do you plan to start your study? When do you plan to start your study in the United States? For fall 2020, 2021, or later, or not sure yet? And the third one is, where are you currently watching this event from? Are you in Jabodetabek area or outside of Java or in Kalimantan or other region in Indonesia, or maybe outside of Indonesia? And the last question is, have you had an advising session with Education USA at America Advisor before, in person or virtual? Okay, 1 minute has passed. I still have 70%, 76% votes. I'm going to wait for like about 1 minute 30 seconds in total. So that's like another 15 seconds. Okay, so before I, you know, end the poll, I want to let you know that the interview will be about 25 minutes. And I expect you to kind of like take notes so that it will be helpful for you and you will know what kind of things you want to ask in the Q&A section later on after the recording of the interview. Okay, time's up for the poll. Can we end the poll, Fina?
Yep.
And share it to all of us here.
Yay.
Here we go. Okay, we got majority of master applicants for tonight, and that's mostly our you know, major attendees and advisees are. So we have 34 students here to apply for master, two for PhD and one for bachelor. And for fall 2021 and later term, we got majority there, and I'm not sure yet. I totally understand that. Both Fina and me know that this is a very challenging time for those of you who are applying or even already accepted, because the uncertainty of, you know, the visa application and the deferral and everything. So yeah, we are here for you. If you have any question, you need any support, you are not alone. Make sure that you get the things that you need, and use us to, you know, to your advantage. And the third question, we have majority from Jabodetabek, and we also have those who are outside of Java. One in Kalimantan, hello, and one in Papua, four from Sumatra. Wow, this is quite unusual, Fina.
Yeah. And
we got two from Sulawesi and none from Indonesia, none from outside of Indonesia. All right, I'm very happy because we are, you know, this going digital thing actually makes a lot of things that maybe that we cannot do when we are back in At America Pacific Place Mall, which is, you know, having audiences interact from other places in Indonesia as well. So being online makes it possible. And the fourth one, majority of the attendees tonight, which is 30, have not done advising session with us yet. So yeah, that's very good that we know that you never done it before, but we don't want to intimidate you to just go online and join us in Zoom and you know, talk with us directly, because you never meet us before in person or in virtual aside from tonight. You can simply send us email first if you are, you know, shy, or if you decide to jump into Zoom to meet us, go ahead and do so. We will provide the Zoom meeting ID in the chat box, and for those of you who are watching in the other social media, don't worry, I will repeat the Zoom ID later on after we are having discussion. So okay, yeah, I want to remind you, take notes, because this interview will be done in Bahasa Indonesia. And if you have question, you want to make sure that you have it and you can share it with us in the chat box. Send it to everyone. Don't send it privately. Okay, Fina, you have...
Yeah, no, just real quick, because the interview that we're going to have, the video is actually the question is very on point. So I really hope, again, like what Santika said, notes, but then at the same time, during when you watch the video, you are also more than welcome to keep the questions coming. So yeah. Once we are done with the video, we'll be happy to take as many questions as possible. All right. So I think it will be fun. So yeah.
Okay. Enjoy the interview with Irfan. Hi everyone, untuk Indonesian Student Success Stories hari ini, aku kedatangan tamu spesial, one of my good advices, Muhammad Irfan Hasan. Irfan sudah keterima oleh Columbia University untuk program Master Adult Learning and Leadership, dan juga dia mendapatkan beasiswa LPDP or Indonesia Endowment Fund for Education. So, aku hari ini bakal menginterview Irfan dan kita bakal sharing a lot of things from his stories and journey. Hi Irfan, congratulations!
Hello, how are you?
Good! Congratulations and thank you so much for
thank
your
you.
Time and your willingness to share with us today ya.
Okay.
Jadi hari ini kita bakal ngobrolin banyak hal tentang perjalanan kamu apply LPDP, apply Columbia University. Oke, aku mulai pertanyaan pertama ya. Oke, update terakhir untuk LPDP bagaimana? Apakah keberangkatan tahun ini akan ditunda?
Jadi dari LPDP mengeluarkan panduan terbaru, panduan COVID-19 untuk UARD. Di situ sih dituliskan selama situasi pandemik, awardee tidak boleh berangkat ke luar negeri. Jadi ada poin itu. Nah, kita belum tahu sejauh mana ini situasi pandemik yang dimaksud, apakah yang ditetapkan oleh WHO atau bagaimana. Ya, intinya sih sampai sekarang peraturannya masih seperti itu. Jadi tidak boleh berangkat selama ada pandemi. Tapi kalau misalnya universitasnya mengadakan kuliah online dan membolehkan untuk kuliah online, kita bisa mulai dengan online, gitu. Okay. Itu sih update terakhir ya dari LPDP.
Oke, okay, itu lumayan dikasih flexibility ya, dikasih options. So, yes. I think that's a positive part. Kalau untuk Columbia University-nya gimana? What options do they give to you? Kamu dikasihnya apa aja?
Ya, aku sendiri masih menunggu dari Columbia University untuk announcement-nya karena untuk fall sendiri belum ada pengumuman khusus bagaimana metodenya. Yang pasti satu semester ini sampai fall itu sudah diputuskan online pastinya. Apalagi Columbia University ada di New York, epicenter dari kasus COVID ya di sana. Gitu. Jadi memang masih menunggu sih apakah metode di fall ini akan online atau bisa face-to-face.
Do you keep in touch with someone in Columbia University biar kamu stay updated gitu sama perkembangannya mereka sekarang?
Iya, jadi kalau dari Columbia University sendiri pertama mereka ngadain banyak webinar ya. Kemudian terkait kasus COVID ini saya dengan teman saya ada satu orang juga di jurusan yang sama korespondensi dengan program direkturnya. Menyampaikan ya keluh kesah kita lah, kita bercerita di sini kondisinya dari scholarship juga saat ini belum bolehkan untuk berangkat ya, sampai menunggu perkembangan situasi. Dari dia sih menyampaikan kalau di situasi ini mestinya sih bisa untuk defer setahun. Di jurusan aku artinya defer setahun karena gak ada entry di spring. Itu atau kalau memungkinkan ya online, tapi itu juga masih mungkin. Nah, mereka sendiri belum memutuskan apakah metode pembelajaran di fall akan bisa face to face atau online. Itu sih sejauh ini.
Oke, thank you update-nya. Jadi kamu sekarang selain menunggu, kamu berbenah nonton webinar-webinar mereka ya?
Iya. Nonton webinar-webinarnya, ikut ya kalau misalnya ada event kumpul dengan current student atau chit-chat tentang course yang ada di sana, ikut aja. Semuanya via Zoom sekarang gitu.
Okay, that's nice. Terus kalau untuk, nah ini kan kita udah ngomongin kamu
keterima LPDP, keterima Columbia. Nah, kita sekarang flashback dulu, kamu tuh mulai mikir perlu S2 atau master degree itu dari kapan sih?
Mulai pengen S2 ya, jadi mungkin sekitar 3 tahun setelah, 3 tahun kerja lah. Jadi kalau dihitung mungkin sejak 3 tahun sebelum submission ya, untuk mulai mikirin S2-nya. Jadi aku pengalaman di learning and development selama 5 tahun kurang lebih, kemudian di marketing 1 tahun. Ya, setelah itu, setelah aku ngerasa enjoy sepertinya di learning and development, ya aku pengen ada pengalaman dan pembelajaran, mempelajari lebih dalam terkait field ini, barulah kepikiran S2. Nah, dari situ mulai cari-cari jurusannya. Jadi pertama yang aku cari adalah jurusan. Mulailah pakai keyword, keyword learning and development, training and development, learning design, education technology, sampai termasuk di dalamnya adult learning juga. Gitu. Aku cari jurusan mana yang pas ya. Kemudian mempertimbangkan juga universitasnya. Karena kalau aku mau kuliah di US, sudah menghitung-hitung, pasti harus dengan scholarship. Ya. Jadi, disesuaikan juga dengan list universitas di scholarship-nya. Dalam hal ini termasuk LPDP. Ya, di LPDP sendiri ada list universitas, sekarang mungkin dibatasi ya. Ada universitas-universitas yang bisa pilih all major. Nah, biasanya itu top university. Kebanyakan sih kalau aku lihat di listnya memang kebanyakan universitas di US, termasuk salah satunya Columbia University. Jadi masuklah itu Columbia University, jurusannya pas, kemudian ya sesuai banget sama pengalaman pekerjaan juga. Dan memang kebetulan aku ingin mendalami bidang itu. Jadi ya itu pilihan yang pas gitu, menurut aku. Gitu sih.
Oke, jadi kamu mulai kepikiran mau master tuh setelah punya pengalaman kerja 3-4 tahun ya?
Iya.
Sebenarnya kayak yang kamu jelasin, itu step 1 and step 2 kalau di Education USA, guidance to help any advices to study in US. Jadi step 1 itu researching your options. So, yang kayak kamu bilang, unitnya apa, programnya apa, yang cocok sama kamu, yang kamu mau apa. Terus step 2 is financing your studies. Ya, itu yang kamu bilang, yang kamu pasti habis ngelihat cost-nya dan segala macam, kamu nyari scholarship. Kalau aku bisa summarize step 1, step 2 itu, kamu kira-kira ngabisin waktu berapa lama di situ?
Jujur pertama kali sih, karena nyari jurusan agak lebih susah, aku lebih fokus juga untuk applying scholarship-nya, jadi LPDP. Gitu. Ya, bisa dibilang setahun lah. Okay. Yang untuk cari
nyari mana sama tepat universitasnya ya, sama fixate that you want to apply LPDP. Nah, tapi in reality kamu tuh kemarin submitnya yang mana dulu, LPDP dulu atau Columbia University dulu?
LPDP dulu. Jadi aku dapatnya di LPDP di Desember 2019, kemudian ada pengumuman keterima di Columbia University-nya di Februari.
Oke, okay, jadi apply-nya LPDP and then Columbia University ya. Oke. Okay. Yeah. So, pas apply LPDP, kamu pilih kampusnya apa aja? Kan dia emang memberikan kamu more than one options ya?
Oke. Okay. Pertama, perlu diketahui juga nih LPDP, itu aku interview-nya 2 kali. Jadi, yang interview pertama gak lolos.
Oke.
Okay. Gitu. Waktu interview pertama, itu universitasnya cuma 1 pilihannya. Di interview kedua, 3. Gitu. Nah, di waktu milih 3 ini, aku memilih dengan kesadaran bahwa ini akan dipertimbangkan saat interview. Gitu. Jadi, di situ aku pilih tentu prioritasnya yang pertama Columbia University. Di sini dia Teachers College. Teachers College ini adalah Graduate School of Education, Health, and Psychology. Aku sendiri adalah background-nya dari farmasi. Gitu, farmasi dan kerjanya juga di industri farmasi. Nah, biasanya dari pengalaman aku di interview pertama, aku tahu akan di cecar dengan kesesuaian, ya, kesesuaian jurusan dengan jurusan S2 yang akan diambil. Jadi aku mempersiapkan itu. Nah, Teacher Salih adalah Graduate School of Education, Health and Psychology. Jadi ada kemungkinan aku bisa mengarahkannya ke arah sana karena ada health-nya. Kemudian ada juga aku ambil UCL di UK, itu Education dan Health juga. Dan University of Toronto di Kanada, itu ada Education and Adult Development.
So from your story, kamu apply LPDP nggak cuma sekali langsung lolos, langsung dapet ya? Kamu berarti dua kali karena kamu bilang interview yang kedua kali.
Iya, jadi interview yang pertama nggak lulus di 2018 akhir.
Oke, berarti itu tahun 2018 ya kamu apply LPDP, lolos, 2019 dicoba lagi. Itu gimana sih kayak, so lesson learned kamu apa? Yeah. Pertama kali nggak lolos, terus apa yang kamu dapatkan sehingga kamu bisa pakai itu untuk application kedua kali kamu sampai sukses?
Yeah. Okay. Nah, karena jurusan yang aku ambil juga adult learning kan, sebenarnya aku juga baca-baca soal adult learning ini. Sebenarnya making mistakes atau failure itu bagian penting dari pembelajaran untuk adults gitu. Jadi ya untuk kita bisa belajar optimal memang making mistakes salah satu caranya, ya kan? Jadi aku sih melihat kegagalan di interview pertama LPDP itu bermanfaat untuk interview kedua gitu. Jadi memang sudah berencana sih. Pertama aku tahu situasinya, kemudian pertanyaan-pertanyaan apa yang ditanyakan oleh interviewer, ya mengarah kemana dan seperti apa dia mencecarnya. Aku ngerasa sebenarnya interview yang kedua lebih challenging sih. Jadi agak ragu-ragu juga sebenarnya apakah lulus apa enggak. Justru interview yang pertama lebih baik-baik gitu ya. Tahu-tahu enggak lulus. Ya gitu deh.
Ya, aku setuju banget sih sama kamu, karena emang kalau kita nggak pernah make failure, we don't have failure, we don't learn a lot, gitu. Jadi, bagusnya kamu, emang kamu mencoba lagi dan kamu benar-benar belajar dari apa yang menurut kamu bisa kamu improve, gitu ya.
Iya,
Nah, kenapa sih kamu milih Amerika? Kenapa milih United States for your study, for your master?
Mungkin karena acara-acara Education USA juga di Amerika kali ya. Jadi kalau aku menangkapnya, kalau universitas di Amerika itu pertama dia honor white background experiences. Jadi kalau kita punya pengalaman pekerjaan, ya itu dinilai banget sama dia. Kemudian kebanyakan universitas, kalau yang aku tahu adalah dia kan ingin membentuk suasana kelas, ya kan? Artinya dia akan menerima berdasarkan pengalaman atau latar belakang dari masing-masing orang yang diterima, sehingga terbentuklah kelas yang berasal dari berbagai background, gimana masing-masing orang itu akan belajar. Tinggal gimana kita apply, kita akan memposisikan diri sebagai orang yang punya latar belakang apa yang akan memberikan value ke kelas itu, kan gitu. Ya, jadi aku ngerasa ke universitas di US itu pilihan yang tepat karena aku punya pengalaman pekerjaan yang sejalan juga dengan programnya. Lalu aku ngerasa sepertinya universitas di US banyak praktikalnya, jadi ke penerapannya gitu. Jadi aku milih universitas di US.
Kamu ingat gak kamu ke acara Education USA yang mana?
Pertama statement of purpose pastinya, okay. Ya, karena aku pakai materi itu untuk menyiapkan statement of purpose. Kemudian resume pernah juga, terus persiapan TOEFL IBT salah satu kelas pernah juga. Aku office-nya juga di Sudirman, okay. Jadi ke Pacific Place ya dua stasiun naik MRT.
Oke, okay. Jadi kita balik lagi ke application kamu ke Columbia University. Itu kamu application-nya perlu apa aja sama standardized test apa yang kamu ambil?
Oke, okay. Untuk di jurusan aku di Columbia University, Teachers College, Pertama, English skill, karena kita bukan first language-nya English. Untuk English, dia mensyaratkan TOEFL IBT minimal 100 atau IELTS minimal 7. Kemudian, tentu statement of purpose, terus resume, habis itu recommendation letter 3 orang. Itu sih, selebihnya administrasi seperti ijazah, kemudian transkrip nilai gitu yang harus dikirim ke sana.
Jadi gitu. Quite general ya, sebenarnya itu adalah general requirements yang biasa kita kasih tahu ke advisee-advisee lain untuk apply ke universitas di Amerika. Nah, tapi untuk standardized test-nya sendiri, dia ngasih kebebasan TOEFL IBT atau IELTS. Terus kamu pilih yang mana?
Ya, aku pilih IELTS.
Oke. Kamu ngambil IELTS berapa kali? Sekali langsung beres atau?
Aku ngambil IELTS dua kali. IELTS yang pertama dapat nilai minimal untuk apply LPDP. Jadi aku ambil untuk apply LPDP. Kemudian aku ambil IELTS yang kedua untuk bisa apply di Columbia. Karena tadi minimal 7 di Columbia.
Okay. Jadi kamu harus reach that target ya?
Iya. Yeah.
Okay. Tips untuk belajar IELTS untuk mencapai target score seperti kamu tuh kayak gimana kalau kamunya?
Iya. Yeah. Pertama, yang aku ambil first exam, aku sih menganggap itu sebagai baseline ya. Jadi untuk mengetahui di mana aku kekurangannya gitu. Jadi aku bisa lebih belajar, lebih fokus ke arah sana. Niatnya gitu. Jadi waktu yang dipakai untuk ambil tes yang kedua, belajarnya gak terlalu melebar kemana-mana gitu. Dari situ aku tahu aku perlu improve di writing. Jadi aku bisa improve writing-nya lebih baik, tapi untuk listening pun dan juga untuk reading mestinya yang udah bagus bisa lebih bagus lagi dong gitu. Dan juga speaking. Nah, tapi masalahnya aku kan kerja juga ya. Nah, ini susahnya time management gitu. Jadi one of the most challenging part. Nah, untuk itu aku subscribe ke online learning platform gitulah untuk belajar gitu. Terus berusaha manfaatkan waktu yang ada. Jadi aku sadar kan untuk berangkat kerja dari naik mobil kantor butuh waktu sekitar 45 menit. Pulang lebih lama biasanya karena lebih macet ya, 1 jam gitu. Tadinya biasanya kita dengerin radio kan selama perjalanan itu. Nah, aku sadar tuh di situ kita bisa konekin aja Bluetooth. Kemudian dengerin video lessonnya setiap hari. Jadi improve lah sedikit demi sedikit setiap perjalanan ke kantor itu di saat macet di Jakarta. Gitu. Sampai pernah waktu itu ada satu hari dikirim email dari mereka, kamu adalah super productive watcher video. Tapi dengan catatan dia bilang, tapi kebanyakan student yang sukses itu juga ngerjain soal. Jadi maksud dia, ngerjain soal juga dong, gitu. Aku gak ngerjain soal, gitu kan. Cuman sedikit. Tapi menurut aku sih itu signifikan ya, meningkatkan English skill. Ya, walaupun sedikit demi sedikit di saat traffic di Jakarta. Itu yang aku lakukan.
Oke, ini aku kepikiran jadi kayak little things matter. Jadi kayak emang yang efektif itu adalah kita kayak try out test, try out testnya sendiri langsung ya.
Ya, kalau menurut aku sih gitu. Jadi kita tahu kurangnya di mana, kemudian kita fokus memperbaiki di bagian itu.
Oke. Oke, makasih. That's a very good tips. So next one, berarti kamu tidak untuk program kamu kebetulan mungkin nggak perlu GRE ya?
Kebetulan nggak perlu GRE untuk jurusan aku.
Oke. Next question, kamu ingat gak di kayak kamu kan nulis personal apa statement of purpose, personal essay itu kamu kesulitan gak untuk nulis itu karena banyak sekali yang merasa aduh aku nulis apa ya gitu. Tips kamu apa untuk itu?
Kesulitan sih karena aku gak biasa nulis dalam bahasa Inggris itu yang pertama. Aku jarang nulis bahasa Inggris, jadi butuh waktu untuk berpikir apa yang dituliskan. Apa namanya, writer's block ya. Jadi mungkin memandang layar dalam beberapa waktu itu. tapi aku udah ikut eventnya at America juga kan. Jadi aku ikutin tuh tahapan-tahapan yang ada di sana, termasuk membuka dengan menarik ya, berusaha statement of purpose-nya itu seperti cerita, karena aku tahu orang akan lebih mengikuti tulisan kamu jika lebih flowing ya, seperti cerita gitu. Tapi tetap aku butuh orang untuk membaca itu ya, jadi datanglah aku dan Santika membacanya ya.
Iya, aku ingat datang
memberikan masukan ya.
Iya, aku ingat kamu datang dengan esai kamu. Jadi aku pas baca aku, pertama kali first impression aku sama esai kamu adalah sangat menarik. Mm-hmm. Kamu ingat enggak input esai aku ke kamu apa? Esai kamu ke aku apa?
Yang aku enggak menduga adalah jadi Santika menganggap bahwa background aku dari farmasi UI dan pekerjaan yang lebih ke human interaction itu adalah sesuatu yang unik, dan itu adalah suatu strength yang bisa dimasukkan ke dalam SOP. Tadinya aku gak menganggap itu sebagai strength, tapi setelah dipikir-pikir ya itu saran yang bagus. Jadi masukkan ke sana. Kemudian ada perbaikan-perbaikan seperti aku sebut theoretically ya, kamu sampaikan supaya bisa dipraktekkan langsung juga di sana. Kemudian gimana aku menempatkan diri akan memberikan value yang lebih di komunitas di sana gitu. Jadi lebih menunjukkan keunikan aku pribadi ya, yang akan memberikan value di kelas itu gitu. Jadi ya itu masukan-masukan yang bagus sih.
Oke, okay, I'm so glad that input aku tuh bermanfaat buat kamu dan mungkin membantu sedikit kamu keterima di Columbia University. Jadi ini pertanyaan terakhir, apa pesan kamu buat orang yang mau studi ke Amerika tapi nggak yakin bisa masuk highly selective universities like Columbia University? Jadi orang-orang yang mungkin punya, you know, same want as you, tapi mereka merasa, ah, aku harus apply LPDP nih, RTDP reguler, chance keterimanya sedikit, chance keterimanya kecil sekali, apalagi dengan pilihan-pilihan universitas yang highly selective. Jadi, apa sih tips dan pesan kamu untuk mereka?
Kalau menurut aku sih, yang pertama, mungkin knowing about yourself first, itu jadi a good start. Pertama tadi aku meluangkan waktu yang cukup banyak untuk memilih jurusan dan universitas. Jadi punya dokumentasi apa aja yang udah dilakukan selama ini, itu juga hal yang bagus sih ya. Jadi kita tahu dulu kita mau kemana, kemudian goal kita apa ya. Kemudian kalau misalnya mengambil S2 di US adalah jalan untuk mencapai goal itu ya, dan kamu yakin itu, menurut aku ya do action aja gitu. Jadi pastikan kamu melakukan action-action yang nyata gitu setiap harinya. Di kasus aku sih karena aku juga kerja, bagi aku sih slow gak apa-apa ya, sama kita udah set ekspektasi kapan berangkat, tapi kita memastikan ada progres setiap harinya gitu. Jadi ya progres setiap harinya itu bisa kecil, misalnya tadi di perjalanan ke kantor kayak gitu kan, atau tahapan-tahapan menuju scholarship gitu. Kamu ingin mastiin banget nih di setiap harinya itu ada progres gitu. Kemudian tadi yang kamu bilang ada ketakutan-ketakutan kecil lah jumlah yang diterima gitu ya. Ya ketakutan itu wajar sih dan pasti ada, cuman ya lakuin aja gitu, nggak usah terlalu dipikirin ya, just do it.
Yeah. Ini
kadang orang
make small steps, make small progress, terus learn from your failure, don't give up, karena kamu juga emang you don't just apply one and just get everything. That's why planning ahead of time itu sangat membantu. Kayak Irfan, kamu kan planning sekitar 3 tahun sebelum ini ya. Jadi dari 2016. Yeah. Jadi iya, make sure kita punya enough time to plan karena emang penting banget. Yeah. Oke, thank you banget Irfan. Aku yakin dan banyak orang yang jadi semangat dan terinspirasi buat planning their study to US. And I know even though you are accepted and you just need to go to US after all of this get better, if you need anything else, let us know, karena kita nggak cuma nge-guide kamu sampai, kita nggak cuma nge-guide kamu sampai kamu keterima, tapi juga when you are there in US and when you are back to Indonesia. Terus, again, congratulations and thank you so much. Stay safe and stay healthy.
You too. Stay safe.
Hope you guys enjoy the interview. I hope you learn a lot from the interview tadi. And of course, we are taking questions. But before that, I will give it to Fina because I present this interview as a surprise as well to her. So any comment, Fina?
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. And yeah, I told Santika, Santika was planning to share the pre-recorded video before this event, and I was like, you know what, I'm just gonna watch it just like everybody else. So when I watched the whole interview, I was just like, oh my god, this is so on point. So thank you so much, Santika, for doing this. And I believe Irfan is also in the house. We're going to introduce him very soon. But I took some notes from the whole interview, and I would like to recap some of them real quick. I really like when Irfan mentioned about him being failed on the first LPDP interview, and then the part when he said that it's interesting because the first interview he thought he did really well, and this is something that I actually saw this quite often when it comes to the LPDP interview. So almost the majority of our advisees, after they did the interview, they would go, and then almost everyone who said, I think it went well, you know? And when they said that, almost the majority of them didn't get the LPDP. And it's quite the contrary. When they came to us and then they said, man, I don't know, like, I think, I don't know, like, I don't think I'm gonna get it. And then like a couple of weeks after that, a couple of months, they said, I get accepted. So I don't know what's going on here, but I found it really interesting as well. And so thank you so much, Irfan, for saying that. So maybe that's something, you know, kind of like a little trick. So when you feel that you didn't really ace the interview, we can kind of like probably assume that the real, you know, like a possibility for you to get it. And then another thing is, you know, the part, I mean, I have never met Irfan in person before, but clearly he said that he attended the essay event and the resume, and I would assume that was when I gave that presentation. So thank you so much for joining that event before, and then you found it helpful. And then I really like when you mentioned about writer's block. There is a slide at the end of my presentation where I mention about writer's block and how I tell people that it's very normal when you are, you know, like sitting down in front of your laptop or notebook or something like that, and then you just do not know what to write. That's what happens with a lot of, you know, like writers out there. And that is totally okay if the deadline is still so far away. We basically don't have time for you to have a writer's block if the deadline is, I don't know, like in a couple of weeks. And so now it's still May. And also with the polling results earlier, knowing that the majority of you guys want to study for fall 2021, I know probably the deadline is not until next year or maybe not until the end of this year, but there's no better time to actually start now. So when you have writer's block, just feel it. Just feel the writer's block situation, which is completely normal. And I also like the, when Irfan mentioned that his office is, you know, still nearby. I would say that I really look forward to come back to Ad America very soon when we can also open for public. Because if you have never been to Ad America, we are located at the Pacific Place Mall in SCBD area. I would say it's like the perfect location in Jakarta. And the fact that now there is, you know, MRT, I mean, even before MRT, there is, you know, the Transjakarta and everything. Although, you know, it can be, you know, the traffic can be really bad sometimes, but our location is just in the middle of Jakarta. So, and we always love when our advisors can be in Ad America and see us in person. And then I would also like touch upon a little bit about the IELTS score. So Irfan here decided to take IELTS, which is definitely normal. And we actually have a lot of questions when people ask, should I take TOEFL or should I take IELTS or should I take both? Technically, it's very unnecessary for you to take both tasks because TOEFL and IELTS quite different. TOEFL is an American English, IELTS is a British English. 100% of universities though in the US will accept TOEFL because it's from the US, it's from the United States. But a lot of universities in the US nowadays also accept IELTS. But I wanna touch base a little bit on the score because although LPDP asked 6.5, Columbia asked for 7. And 7, it's the equivalent of 94 for TOEFL IBT. So is it considered high? I want to say yes, because the general score for TOEFL IBT is 79. But this is what makes it, I mean, I want to say it's quite interesting when you want to study in the US, especially on the master's degree level. English is quite important. And then the United States, apparently, especially if you are planning to apply for, you know, a number of highly selective universities in the US, such as Columbia, their score requirement can be quite high. So exactly, Irfan here is a good example. 7.5, that's even better. And yeah, it's 94 in TOEFL IBT, 94 to like about 100. And I also love the part about the fact that Irfan was working, but then also, you know, trying to complete the application. So it's actually doable. The majority of our advisees are those who are interested in studying master's graduate degree level, master's degree and PhD. And then, of course, you are currently working. And is it possible to actually complete the, you know, you can say that the requirement study in the US is quite a lot compared to other countries. And the answer is definitely yes. That's why if you actually start as early as possible, that's even better because it's all about time management and just definitely see what Irfan did. You know, like he would, you know, spend some time, you know, like improve the English. And he mentioned about, like, you know, taking some online resources. So maybe we can ask Irfan more about that. But yeah, no, that's basically, you know, the part where I believe that is very on point. And thank you so much for sharing that. We actually have a lot of questions now from Instagram, from Zoom. So I will give it back to Santika while I compile these questions and then we can start the Q&A.
Okay, so surprise, not surprise, we have Irfan tonight.
Hello.
Hi, Irfan. Thank you so much for doing the pre-recording interview with me and also joining us tonight. I believe your willingness to share is very nice and, you know, your time is so precious as well. So we got the first question and it's directed to you, not us anyway. So this is from Instagram from M. Dayu Utami. So she asked or he asked you, S1 di farmasi mana, Kak? So there you
farmasi,
go.
Farmasi UI.
Farmasi UI, Universitas Indonesia, ya?
Indonesia, ya.
All right, and second question from Cory Mia Sihombing. Bertanya dong, apakah yang diimprove saat interview yang kedua? This is also my question. So there.
Okay. Interview yang kedua, jadi baru sharing juga sama teman-teman yang ikut LPDP juga. Jadi ternyata ada matriks penilaiannya kan. Dan salah satunya adalah antara lain soal keluarga ya. Jadi mereka tentu ingin memastikan supaya setiap awardee bisa menyelesaikan studinya dengan baik. Gitu. Jadi akan ada pertanyaan tentang keluarga ya. Itu harus bisa dijawab dengan baik. Artinya ada hambatan nggak sih saat kamu studi S2 nanti dari sisi keluarga gitu. Kemudian pertanyaan terkait itu tadi kesesuaian jurusan ya. Dan itu kayaknya jadi senjata yang sering dipakai deh kayaknya. Kalau misalnya jurusan yang kita ambil itu berbeda sama S1 yang kita ambil di Indonesia gitu. Kenapa kamu ngambil ini? Apa tujuan yang ngambil ini? Emangnya kamu bisa? Ya kayak gitulah.
Oke, okay, next question adalah dari Esther di Zoom. Ingin tanya Kak Irfan, apakah saat apply scholarship udah dapat LOE dari kampus? Bila belum, bagaimana meyakinkan pihak LPDP? Again, ya ini kamu apply yang reguler dan without LOE ya berarti ya Irfan?
Reguler tanpa LOE. Ya meyakinkan. Yang pertama, aku sih fokusnya jurusan itu sesuai dengan pengalaman yang aku lakukan selama ini. Jadi di kerjaan pun ada inovasi-inovasi yang dilakukan. Sebenarnya agak di-challenge sama interviewernya kayak, ya itu sih inovasi yang orang lain juga udah melakukan, kayak gitu. Jadi interviewernya kayaknya berperan sebagai orang yang akan berusaha membuat kita down gitu ya dengan pertanyaan dengan cara dia merespon gitu. Tapi yang penting fokus apa yang udah pernah kita lakukan sebelumnya dan kita yakin atas pilihan kita bahwa kita sangat interest dengan field ini dan kita yakin bisa menjalani kuliah nanti di sana mendalami bidang ini gitu sih.
Oke, okay, thank you. And next one from Pramita, also in Zoom. Kak, kenapa lebih tertarik ke Teachers College di Columbia University yang background-nya berbeda dengan jurusan S1 Kak Irfan, yaitu farmasi?
Lebih karena pekerjaan sih. Ya, jadi karena udah bertahun-tahun, sebenarnya masih hubungannya dengan farmasi adalah industrinya kan. Industrinya adalah industri farmasi. Jadi terkait dengan dunia kesehatannya, ilmu tentang obatnya sih masih ada sebenarnya gitu. Cuman dari sisi pekerjaan memang lebih ke manusianya, lebih ke membantu orang belajar.
Oke. Gitu. Mungkin kamu mau sharing dikit apa role kamu di kerjaan kamu tuh kayak gimana sehingga bisa disambungkan walaupun it's a pharmacy field tapi what you're doing is about human interaction and learning ya.
Iya. Jadi kan seperti di perusahaan lain di learning and development ya kita membuat orang-orang di dalam perusahaan itu develop jadi berkembang dan mencapai kompetensi yang diharapkan. Ya, kalau di perusahaan aku sendiri biasanya udah ada materi khusus dari global perusahaannya, kemudian kita bisa berinovasi di sana bagaimana cara menerapkannya ke karyawan-karyawan di Indonesia. Intinya sih membuat mereka berkembang sampai di kompetensi tertentu. Gitu.
Oke. Okay. Tapi itu di field yang berhubungan dengan S1 kamu, which is farmasi ya?
Industrinya Okay. Industri farmasi.
Alright, next question-nya masih berhubungan sama itu. So, this is from Karna in Zoom. Mau tanya tipsnya kakak untuk yang S1 dan pekerjaannya beda total sama S2-nya. Gimana ya biar bisa dapat LPDP? So, S1-nya dia sama S2 yang mau diambil ini, nggak S1, pekerjaannya tidak berhubungan dengan S2-nya.
Ya, S2-nya. Ya,
yeah. S2-nya. Jadi, yang nggak align. So, how would you do that? Karena kamu juga intinya nggak gitu align ya, buat apply LPDP S2-nya.
Jadi, aku sadar itu sih di interview 1, dan memang muncul lagi di interview 2, bahwa mereka hampir pasti akan menanyakan itu di interview. Ya, jadi kalau misalnya ada ketidaksesuaian dengan jurusan yang pertama, jadi sadarilah itu akan ditanyakan. Jadi siapkan diri kalau dari sisi aku adalah di Teachers College itu sebenarnya graduate school, tadi yang aku bilang graduate school of education, health, and psychology. Jadi walaupun aku fokus di adult learning and leadership, sebenarnya ada course-course opsional di dalamnya yang aku bisa ambil dari divisi lain yang terkait dengan health. Ya, mungkin itu bisa membantu. Kemudian dikaitkan juga dengan pengalaman di organisasi non-profit terkait dengan gimana sih cara penerapan adult learning ini, tapi masih dihubungkan dengan kesehatan. Gitu sih. Kalau menurut aku yang penting sadari aja bahwa itu akan ditanya dan tetapkan strateginya gimana menjawabnya. Gitu. Kalau kita udah yakin memang jurusan ini yang mau kita ambil.
Oke. Okay. Jadi you just have to be very strong and very sure that you are going to take that, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Next question is still about LPDP, of course. It's very popular. Dari Lorenzo di Zoom. Halo Kak, kan Kak Irfan apply LPDP 2 kali dan salah satu syarat untuk LPDP disuruh buat esai. Saat apply yang kedua kali, apakah esai yang pertama kali masih bisa dipakai atau harus esai terbaru? Apakah tiap tahun topik esai dari LPDP yang diberikan berbeda?
Sepertinya bisa jadi ada perubahan sih, karena di 2000